I feel like I need to put on my teacher voice. Everyone, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It almost worked. No, good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Liselle. I'm one of the leadership team here. I am going to start by praying, and then God has put a word on my heart, and I hope it translates, and I hope that you hear the heart of the message that he's given me. I'm a little bit nervous today. I don't know why. I think I'm just super excited. Baptisms are happening as well, which is extra exciting. So I'm going to pray, and then we'll get started. Lord Jesus, just thank you that we can come into your house on a Sunday morning, that we can be a community together, that we can stand with our brothers and sisters in you, and we can worship you, and we can leave all our struggles and our pain and our worries at the door, at your feet, and we can just come and be with you. Lord, I pray that as I say this message, Lord, that it speaks to people in this room and speaks to people who hear it, Lord God. And Lord, I pray that you just work your miracle. You send your Holy Spirit to speak to everyone today, Lord God. Lord, thank you for the relationship that you have with us. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. So, I love to read. I'm very much a reader. I like a good novel. Do we have anybody else who likes to read in here? Yeah, my mom, definitely. I think I definitely got it from my mom. My love of reading. And I love a good novel. I love getting into a good story, like relating with the characters and going on adventures with them. And I've got a particular love of fantasy stories, of stories that are usually a series. I tend to get stuck into a good series. Things like the Narnia series, The Lord of the Rings, Noughts and Crosses. There's a series called the Ben Dragon series that's all about King Arthur. But what I really, really don't like is when you have a series that doesn't end. And I was speaking to Carla this morning. I started a series that I didn't realize was a series at about the beginning of the year. It was about January time. I downloaded this book on my Kindle. And I read it, and I really enjoyed it. And after it finished, there was a second book. And I was like, oh my goodness, that's amazing. There's a second book. It continues. So I read the second book, and it ended on a bit of a cliffhanger. And I was like, hang on a minute. What's going on? And so I searched for it. And there was a third book. And I was like, yes, a third book. And then Amazon said, pre-order for November 2024. Are you kidding me? I have to wait like 11 months to get the next installment of the story. It's not okay. This is one of the reasons why, as an avid Game of Thrones fan, the TV series, I refuse to read the books because I know that he hasn't finished it yet. I will read them when that last book comes out. But TV series are just the same. Is anybody into binging their TV series? Yeah, big time. A lot of them are very, very frustrating. When they get to the end of the season, they leave you on a bit of a cliffhanger, and you have to wait a whole year until the next season comes out. But then, now, season break. So not only do you have to wait for the next season, now they cut it off in the middle of the season, and you have to wait a few months before the next part of that same season comes out. I currently am refusing to watch Bridgerton until the second half comes out. I've heard a lot of things, I've seen a few spoilers, but I will not watch it until that second half of the season comes out. So please don't tell me what happens. I haven't watched it yet. The Bible is full of incredible stories. The New Testament, in particular, tells the story of Jesus. And it tells how he was born. It tells how he lives. It tells the miracles that he did. It tells what he taught his friends. It tells us about his disciples. It tells us how he dies. And if you want to know more about Jesus, your answers are in this book. In the stories that his friends wrote about him, in the things that he said to his friends, and in the way that he treated people, and the reason why he died. This book is his story. And towards the end of his story, it talks about how he died. And in John 19, 28 to 30, it says, "After this, Jesus, knowing that it was all finished, said to fulfill the scripture, 'I thirst.' A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit." Jesus, it is finished. It's the end. The story is done. There is no doubt that Jesus lived. History agrees with that fact. They say he was alive, that he was baptized, that he was... And that, according to history, is the end of Jesus' story. He was alive, he was baptized, he died, the end. And when Jesus says, "It is finished," he uses the word tetelestai. And this means that the sacrifice is accomplished. He has done it. In the Jewish calendar, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would enter the temple and he would make a sacrifice. And that sacrifice would represent all the sins of the Jewish people. As soon as he'd killed the lamb, the priest would come out of the temple and he would declare to the people, "Tetelestai, it is finished," signaling to all the Jews that their sins had been placed on the lamb when it was killed and it was over. They don't need to worry about their sins anymore. Of course, it never really was finished. The sacrifice was never truly accomplished because even with the best lamb in the world, the sins that it took on couldn't be sustained forever. The process had to be repeated every single year until Jesus. He was the ultimate sacrificial lamb. He was pure. He was blameless. He was out without sin. Yet because the Father had sent him to do so, and because he loves you, he took on your sin and died so that you can be blameless in the eyes of God. Luke 19, verse 10 says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." The sacrifice Jesus made was not just for the sins of Israel, but for the sins of the whole world, past, present, and future. When we look objectively at the Bible, we see the crucifixion as the end. But actually, it's not the end. In this part of the Bible, I'm reading from John, that part that I read from John, there's still another two chapters after Jesus said, "It is finished." There's also, in this Bible, another 117 pages. The story is not finished. To the disciples who walked with Jesus at the time, it looked like it was finished to them too. Despite everything Jesus had said to them, despite all of his warnings of his coming death, despite everything that he said, the reason why he was getting crucified, they knew that it was coming and yet they didn't understand what he was there to do. Like I said earlier, I'm a big fan of the Narnia series and thankfully they made a couple of films of it. And I just want to show you this clip from the film of the Dawn Treader. Let's just watch it and then I'll talk about it after.
This is our last time here, isn't it?
Yes. You have grown up, my dear one. Just like Peter and Susan.
Will you visit us in our rooms?
I shall be watching you always. In your world, I have another name. You must learn to know me by it. That was the very reason you were brought to Narnia. That may know me here for a little. You may know me better there.
Will we meet again?
Yes, dear one. One day.
Thank you.
So Lucy's coming to the end of her journey with Aslan in Narnia. And Aslan says that he's still here. He's still there. He's still going to be in her world. He's just going to be known by another name. And she needs to get to know him by that name. And when Jesus died, that's what he was doing with his disciples. He was saying, my time with you has been so that you could get to know me now, but that's so you could then get to know me better when I am gone, that you could understand truly why I was here when I am gone. In Luke 22, verse 44 to 49, it says, then he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets, the Psalms, must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. When Jesus says it is finished, it wasn't the end of the story. It was the end of human separation from God. The story is not finished. The mission was fulfilled. The mission that was foretold in the Old Testament. That's why when we read the Old Testament, we have to do it knowing the New Testament, knowing why Jesus came to earth. Throughout his life on earth, Jesus fulfilled over 300 Old Testament prophecies. Now, I don't know the statistics of how impossible that is, but I know I have seen a video online that told me about it, but it's all numbers, so it goes wild over my head. But the statistics of somebody fulfilling over 300 prophecies is minute. It is practically, statistically, pretty impossible. But Jesus did it. Verse 45 said, then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. Jesus is showing the disciples here what he has done and who he truly is. They finally get it. You know, if you read the New Testament, it's constantly the disciples going, I don't understand why he said that. I don't get why he's doing that. Why has he said that? I don't understand. They get it now. Jesus has made the sacrifice, he's resurrected, he's come back, and he's opened their minds to scripture. They finally get it. And Jesus' mission is fulfilled, but his agenda is just beginning. Verse 47 to 49 says, and that repentance of the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. Jesus has done his job. Now he's given his disciples a mission. Everything that they have witnessed, everything that they have learned about Jesus, everything that they have learned in their time with him, they now need to tell the world about it. Jesus came to the world to save humanity. This was an integral part of God's plan for the world. John 10, verse 15 to 18 said, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep, and I have other sheep that are not of this fold, I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I might take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Jesus has done his part. He made that choice. If you read the scriptures, he is down on his knees saying, please, God, don't make me do this, but he still does it because he loves you. Because he knew that 2,000 years later, you lot would be sitting in this room asking for a relationship with Jesus. That's why he did it, because he knows you and he loves you. And he thought, you are worth it. But now it's our turn to do something. Yes, not just to use his disciples 2,000 years ago, us. We are Jesus' disciples now. We have a job to do. And for those of you who are note takers, I've broken down this mission into 4 points. And the first point, the first thing that we need to do, we need to preach. At the end of every gospel and at the beginning of Acts, we are called to preach the name of Jesus. Matthew 28:19-20 says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age." Mark 16:15 says, "And he said to them, go into the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation." John 20:21-23 said, "Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. And when he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Acts 1:8 says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." No matter how you look at it, we are called to talk about Jesus. And the word preach can have some negative connotations. You know, there's a word that we use in society today, and it's being preachy. If somebody's preachy, it means that they've got a tendency to give moral advice, but it's in a tedious and a self-righteous way. It's one of the reasons why people don't come to church, because they don't want to be preached at. They don't want to be told that what they're doing is wrong and that they need to change and that something has to give. But when it comes around to preaching about Jesus, it's not tedious. It's not self-righteous. It's about him. It's not about us. So we need to think about preaching differently. Jesus isn't about being tedious. He's not about being self-righteous. Jesus is the complete opposite of those two words. Jesus is relational. Jesus is humble. In Mark 9:33-35, it says, "And they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, what were you discussing on the way? But they kept silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12, and he said to them, if anyone would be first, he must be last of all and servant of all." Jesus is humble. He doesn't want us to stand up on a pulpit and be like, this. He wants us to serve each other. He wants us to love each other. And that's how we tell the story of Jesus. It's not through you are wrong and I am right. It's through I love you because Jesus loves me. You know, this week has been half term, and as a teacher, I have massively appreciated it. And I've had a lovely time. I've been off with my family. My husband managed to get the week off as well. On Monday, we met up with some friends. We had breakfast with the Crawfords, and then we went across to town and we met some old friends of my husband's. Tuesday, we had a special date with our eldest. We took him to the cinema. We went to see If, very good movie if you want to see it. And then on Thursday, we went as a family to Legoland and had a really good time. My little baby's first time at a theme park, and it was very exciting. And he pretty much spent the whole time when he was on rides like this. But I want to talk about these things because I shared them with people that I love. I enjoyed them. I had a good time. I can recommend that the cafe that I went to for breakfast on Monday, I can recommend the movie. It was good fun. And the experience that I had with my family was so good that it had an impact on me. It has made memories. In the same way, when we preach, we talk about Jesus. We talk about what we've learned about him. We talk about what he's done in our lives. Jesus made the biggest impact anybody could possibly make. He died for you. He chose to die for you so that you could have a relationship with God, so that you don't have to do this life on your own. And you can call upon God to share every moment with you, you're good, you're bad, you're ugly, and all the moments in between. So why would you not talk about that? Preaching isn't just for people on this platform, isn't just for people who are standing on a stage on a Sunday with a microphone in their hands. It's something that we should all be doing. It's something that we are called to do. You know, today we're having our baptisms, and some people in our congregation are going to be baptized, and as part of that, they've been asked to share the reasons why they are getting baptized. This is all Jesus is asking us to do, to make a public declaration of our faith, to talk about why we love Jesus. In baptism, we're following Jesus' command to preach to the world because we are preaching to our world. We're preaching to our friends, our families, and when we invite them to witness our baptisms. By sharing our personal stories with Jesus, our testimony, we're following Jesus' command. Not only that, but in baptisms, we're actively washing away our old selves. The selves that had to do it all on our own. The self that made mistake after mistake after mistake. And when we rise from the water in a baptism, we are made brand new in the eyes of God. We are letting Jesus take control so that we don't have to worry about our mistakes anymore, because Jesus will support and guide us through. And that's point number two. Jesus asks us to preach about repentance and forgiveness. Verse 47 says, "And that repentance for the forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name." We like to talk about forgiveness, don't we? It's the nice part of the relationship with God. He died so that we can be forgiven. Forgiveness is the act of freeing from an obligation, guilt or punishment, pardon, cancellation, forgiveness. When we think about the enormity of our failings, the enormity of our mistakes, our weaknesses, the idea that somebody could forgive every single one of these, not only forgive them, but completely cancel them out, is amazing. Thank God for his grace that he would even consider doing that for us. Ephesians 2, 8, verse 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast." Forgiveness is freely given. We don't have to keep doing things to get forgiveness. There's one thing that we have to do, and it's easy. It's simple. We have to repent. That comes first. Forgiveness is God's part in the relationship. Repentance is ours. Luckily, it's not that hard to do, because all we have to do is recognize that we are on the wrong journey. We're going the wrong way, and we needed to make a deliberate change of mind. We need to change direction, turn a corner, and start walking with Jesus. That's all repentance is. It is a choice to stop living for ourselves and to start living for Jesus. There's a song that we sing in church. I'm not deciding whether to sing it or just say it. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. That means you make a choice and you don't look back. It's a simple U-turn. We give it all to Jesus. We give it all to God, and he forgives us. Jesus taught repentance. Matthew 4:17 says, "From this time, Jesus began to preach, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" Luke 24:27 is telling us that we need to preach repentance. Repentance and forgiveness go hand in hand. But repentance consists of belief in Jesus and our choice to follow him daily. Forgiveness's part is God's part, without which no moral life, even an exceptionally moral life, can ever have hope of meeting God's standard. No matter how good we are, no matter how many good choices, no matter how wonderful we live our lives, if we don't have Jesus, we can't be forgiven, because we will never be good enough. If we overemphasize repentance, we'll end up with legalism. salvation by strict obedience to the law. You cannot do this, you cannot do that, you cannot live this way. And church has a bad reputation for that. But God doesn't say that it's about this, that, and that. He says it's about repentance. You come to Jesus, you say sorry, you say, I give it to you, and he takes it away. If we overemphasize forgiveness, we end up with a bit of sloppy grace that distorts the gospel. It's not all about forgiveness. We've got to do something as well. We have to make that choice to follow Jesus. The two go together hand in hand. A decision and a determination to put Jesus first, and a recognition that none of us is without sin. We need God's continual forgiveness and grace. The third point is that the gospel is for everyone. Verse 47 again says that repentance and forgiveness of the sin should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations. Another element of all four gospels and the beginning of Acts that they have in common is that the gospel should be told to everyone. His message of salvation is not just for Jewish people. It's for everyone. Lucky us. Thank God that he loved the world and not just the Jewish people. In Isaiah 49, so in the Old Testament, it even mentions, I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach the end of the earth. Jesus came down to break all barriers. He broke cultural barriers. He broke social barriers. He broke stereotypes. He ate with sinners. He hung out with tax collectors. He did not discriminate. He loves every single one of us. Doesn't matter where we come from. He asks just for your belief in him. When he asks us to tell the world about him, this is all he wants. When we realize that Jesus is not picky, but he is just purely love for everyone, who are we to judge? You know, often when we do feel like we want to talk about Jesus, we sometimes make snap decisions, don't we? We look at the person that we think, oh, I want to talk about Jesus with them, but we think, well, there's no need for me to talk about Jesus with them because their life is perfect. Look at them. They've got everything. They don't need Jesus. Or it might be the opposite. You know what? They've got nothing. They don't need Jesus. Or they're an atheist. They don't believe in Jesus, so why should I even try? They're too logical to have faith. They believe in science, so how could they possibly understand Jesus? Jesus didn't make those judgments. He loves everyone. He asks us to share his story with everyone. He wants to have a relationship with everyone. So when we stand there and we judge people and we say, well, we don't need to tell them about Jesus, who are we? Who are we to stand in Jesus' name, in Jesus' way? We don't know that the impact that we have. Someone asks you, what did you do this weekend? Tell them you went to church. Don't be afraid. Don't fob them off. Don't tell them that, oh, I had a nice weekend, I had a nice Saturday with my family, hung out with some friends on Sunday. Tell them that you came to church. Tell them that you had an amazing time. Because it doesn't take much. God can make a massive impact with just a small bit of information. And you, when you say that, you followed up on what Jesus asked you to do. Jesus asked you to talk about him. When somebody asks you, what did you do on the weekend? You said, I went to church, I had an amazing time. You're doing it. You are preaching. You are telling the world. You are telling your world about Jesus. God can work miracles through that one simple conversation. He is far greater than we can comprehend. If we don't say it, God is still capable of making an impact in that person's life. But it's that little bit harder. And the final point, we don't have to do any of this on our own. God sent the Holy Spirit. Verse 49 says, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. This promise of the Father is spoke about in the Old Testament. And in Isaiah 44 verse 3, it says, "For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon your offspring and my blessing on your descendants." It's talking about the Holy Spirit. When we make the decision to follow Jesus and make him the center of our world, we not only receive forgiveness, but we get direct access to God through the Holy Spirit. John 14, 16 to 17 says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." When Jesus calls us to preach repentance and forgiveness to all nations, he doesn't expect us to do it on our own. Verse 49 says, "You are clothed with a power from on high." When we are clothed with the Holy Spirit, we take on his characteristics. We take on his virtues. We take on the intentions of Jesus. We are surrounded by him. We're no longer stepping out on our own. We're no longer trying to fumble through this life by ourselves, but actually we're doing it on the power and the understanding of Jesus through the strength of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, I would not be here today if it wasn't for the Holy Spirit. And I don't just mean here in life. And no, I wouldn't be here in life if it wasn't for the Holy Spirit. But I mean on standing here on this platform saying these words. Anyone who knows me knows that I am a socially awkward, quiet little hermit who would much rather be sat at home with a cup of tea with my family than in a room full of people, especially one where I am standing at the front and everybody's looking at me. But God had a bigger calling on my life, bigger than I could ever have imagined. And only through the power and the authority of the Holy Spirit am I able to stand here and share what I have learned about Jesus with you. We all need that power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And to get it, all we have to do is pray and seek God in all that we do. And the Holy Spirit will guide us through this complicated thing we call life, using Jesus' teachings and commandments as the compass to guide us to the right path. Jesus' commands and promises did not end the day that he died on the cross. His story is not finished. There's more to come. There is still more to come. Our message is repentance and forgiveness of sins. We are commanded to declare this to all the people throughout the world. We are witnesses to what we know about Jesus. And we must wait before God until he gives the power of his Spirit. The power is not in us. I'm gonna pray. Lord Jesus, I just pray that you send your Holy Spirit today. That you allow us just to be part of your world, Lord God. We thank you that you do this for us. Lord, we worship you. Lord, as we have learned that it is not the end, it is the beginning of your mission. Lord, we thank you that you have given us this mission. We thank you that you give us the power and the authority to speak as your children and to tell the world about the wonderful things that you have done in our lives. And Lord, thank you that we don't have to do this on our own. In your holy name, we pray and we worship you. And as we go out into our week, into our world, Lord God, I pray that you give us the Holy Spirit. You send him to give us the strength and the confidence to talk about you. To tell the people in our world what we did this Sunday, who we met, what we learned, and the wonderful things that we have seen and done through Jesus. Amen.
the world. But it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade, were never enough. And you came along. Thank you.